We're very pleased that Richard Hutton, who's a famous Dutch designer, found he's on a short visit in Tbilisi, and he found time, and with the invitation of Free University Visual Arts and Design School, he found time to come and give a talk about his work. We've sent out the information to the students about what you've been doing and about your work. And what I found the most interesting and what I wanted, since we're in the university, to ask you about the Eindhoven Design Academy,
mm-hmm.
where you went to, because still here in Georgia, when we're talking about design, it's very much compartmentalized, you know, interior, industrial,
mm-hmm.
interior, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So what I found at Eindhoven Design Academy, it's very interdisciplinary, and it's also very much oriented on men and
definitely.
Conceptual.
Yes.
And even when you talk about different departments, it's men and mobility. And it's more enhancing or sort of trying people to think in terms of design rather than say you are interior designer and let's make something like
mm-hmm.
that. So if you could just tell us about your experience with school and how it was done, other than what we could see on their website and find out about it, and what was your experience and how the tutor system worked there, that would be great. I think it would be interesting for everybody.
When I studied there, that was in the second half of the 80s in the last century, the school was called Academy for Industrial Design.
So
I went there to study industrial design. There were three departments, and during my study they changed the whole system, so there was a lot of energy going on. The students were doing what they wanted because the teachers and the whole staff was too busy changing this whole system, and there was a really strong vibe going on amongst the students. It's not for nothing that it's the golden generation of the academy in Eindhoven. I'm the same generation as Jürgen Bij, Hella Jongerius, Tord Boontjes, a bunch of the designers which are now really famous from Holland, mm-hmm. are exactly from my generation, which is really amazing. They changed the system because they wanted to have the focus more on conceptual design. I think that's very good. I think I was one of the first one graduating with really serious conceptual design. And of course, it's very important that you put the man central in your design. The most things we design as a designer are made for people. Of course, we make sometimes a doghouse or something, but the core is designing for people.
Mm-hmm.
So that should be in the center of the focus, and developing concepts, you know. To make a drawing you can always learn, but to get ideas you really have to train the students to develop ideas, strong ideas, and that's the essence of designing, and that's why they have to focus there.
In a way, the motto for your studio is sort of prompting people to be more conceptual. You're saying, I think it goes like, design, I'm not here to solve the problems, but to create possibilities, which creating possibilities is about, you know, thinking creatively.
Definitely. Traditionally, the definition of design is solving a problem. So a company needs a product to solve a problem. And that's already negative, because then you start with a problem. And I don't like problems. And if you create possibilities, that's much more positive, and it's also more open. It's also more about the people who are using it.
Mm-hmm.
It's for them, and they can do whatever they want with it.
One other question about that I will ask, and then I will let you go with that, with your presentation, is about the materials, because. You know, like how I was looking at, and you work in very different materials.
Mm-hmm.
And here when the students are studying, whether they're studying textile design or something, it's very traditional, so it's no like experimentation with the materials. And even when looking at and how materials can prompt new ideas, you know, with, when you're working with a new material, it sort of dictates the way your design or your creative process will go. And how was that like working with the materials and working within the studio at the academy when you were there? I know it was a long time ago.
So when I was there, it was really based on the Bauhaus model. So there were a lot of workshops, and I really spent a lot of time really making what I came up with, and I think making is in a way thinking. Mm-hmm. It's a form of thinking, and I think it's very important to have this hands-on mentality. In the end, we make objects which you can touch and feel and have shape and are materialized, and that you have sort of a feeling with what you're designing. That I think that's very, very good and important. And I like to work with all the materials. So there are so many beautiful materials, and more are being developed, and mm-hmm. That's interesting to play with.
Thanks. I guess, you know, we'll have more questions we can ask you later. If you
no, please ask the questions now. We start with the questions. because I had a rough night last night, I can tell you, so my brain is not functioning very well, but maybe I can give you some answers on your questions, because you're here to learn. I'm here to share, so you can ask me anything.
All right, so I wanted to know, when I was looking at your work, it's my first question, but then somebody else can. How did you start, like, how did you decide to be a designer? Because this is our first year of, you know, when we are having the students and the school just opened. And a lot of students, it was the first time that we had an acceptance, or the students had to present their portfolios.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was a few people who showed up and they were saying, I want to be an architect, or I want to be a designer. And I was thinking, you know, how come at that early age, or what makes one, when does one decide that they want to be architect or designer or so and so? When did you decide, and how did you end up with that? Were you drawing? Were you artistic? What was your, you know?
So I never decided to become a designer. I was born a designer. Mm-hmm. And I was making things since I was a kid, always, all the time. Nowadays, design is very popular. If I go to a birthday party and I tell I'm a designer, oh, that's cool. 25 years ago, when I went to a birthday party, I said I'm a designer. Oh, what are you doing? Oh, well, this bottle, this shape doesn't come out of a factory for nothing. Somebody made a drawing. Oh, yeah, that makes sense. Oh, so then you design, you make the drawing. So I really had to explain.
Uh-huh.
What the job of a designer was, which is totally different today.
But then, you know, your generation, because now that, you know, the group of like drug design, mm-hmm. is you guys sort of really changed the face of design. I mean,
totally,
that, you know,
totally.
You say, yeah. So how come was it like that? Because everybody was asking you at the birthday parties for the design.
No,
we
are now recovering from a crisis in Europe. I don't know how it is here. But at that time we had a serious crisis, which was way bigger than now. At that time there were in Holland 700,000 unemployed people. Now there are 500,000 unemployed people, to show how serious that crisis mm-hmm. was. So there was no work for designers anyway. You could not find a job. This was very simple. I did some internships in some studios, and I thought, well, I'm not going to work for a company. Let's start my own anyway. So mm-hmm. I want to work on a very sort of free spirit mentality. We can do whatever we want. We do it ourselves, and that was a mentality which was among more designers. And we just started to make things.
Mm-hmm.
Which we like. Sometimes even we found objects or whatever, doesn't matter. We wanted to create and we wanted to make things, and we had ideas which we wanted to show to the world. And then in 1993, 2 years after my graduation, René Raamakers, he was the editor-in-chief of Items, the most important design magazine, And Gijs Bakker, a famous designer, was also a tutor in Eindhoven. They said, well, there are a few of designers in Holland working in various places, some from Rotterdam, some from Amsterdam, some from Eindhoven, Arnhem, Utrecht, which are making such an interesting work. We have to show this to the world. Yeah? So in February 1993, they said, we have to show this to the world. In April 1993, Droog Design had their first presentation during the furniture fair in Milan. And at that time, there was the slick Italian design, which was the only thing. And then this bunch of young, crazy Dutch designers came with a total new approach to design, which was never seen before. During the week, the word spread in the town, and at the end of the week, it was totally packed at the exhibition. Like, wow, this is amazing! This is really new and really fresh. The next day, I was on the cover of the New York magazines, and then the shit started.
Hit the fan, as yeah. Right. And so it was basically.
And so you had your question. Anybody else a question? I heard you prepared.
What is your special experience and background?
What do you mean by special experience?
During your education and becoming an artist in the future, when you were studying?
So when I was studying, I was working 24 hours on making stuff really, really hard. We were with a really nice group of students, which were all very motivated, and we did whatever we wanted, and that's the only thing to do with. And in between, we partied a lot. So we had a lot of fun, and we worked very hard. If you want to be good at something, you have to work on it 10,000 hours, and otherwise you can never become good at it. Any more questions? Okay, well, maybe I should show some slides then. I will show something of Droog Design. I will give you a brief introduction to the history of design. Design is invented in Holland. It's an invention by Gerrit Rietveld. He was an architect. And in 1917, almost a century ago, he designed this chair, which was a total revolutionary chair. Because at that time people were sitting only in this Baroque dark wood type of chairs, and then all of a sudden he made this chair. It was in the time of the Stijl, a movement in art in Holland, where he was part of, and he created this total revolutionary chair, which was never seen before. A few years later, somewhere in the 20s, he designed this chair, which is probably the most influential chair in the history of chair, because this was the very first chair where the seat and the back are made in one part. Today, that's probably one of the most common typologies in chairs, but at that time it was never done before. Which is really unique, and it's really the first time that there was a chair like this. The same period, another Dutch architect, Mart Stam, invented the swivel chair. So this he made the very first chair without back legs. Also, that this was a total new typology. Still valid today. The original chair he designed is still in production at Tournai, a German company. He also designed it while he lived in Germany at the Bauhaus. We briefly mentioned Droog Design before, so I quickly will show you some of this work which was launched on this first exhibition. This is a fantastic piece by Theo Remy. It's called "You Can't Lay Down Your Memories." It was his graduation project, which made him famous overnight. And he had this Robinson Crusoe story that I'm on this island, and I have to design with everything I find in the island. So he found a lot of drawers. What a coincidence! And then he put this belt around it, and he made this very playful, sort of random stacked, iconic piece of furniture. and it's not art, I have it at home, and you can actually use this object. So this is another thing he did, it was launched at the first Droog Design Show. He found also on this beach a lot of rags, and he made, out of this old fabric, he made this chair. And he found a lot of milk bottles, which he turned into a lamp. This was my work at the first Droog Design exhibition. It's the table chair. It's one chair made out of two tables. It's a small table where you can sit on, and a bigger table with a piece cut out, which becomes the arm and back rest. That period was definitely my most published item. It's a part of all the serious museums in the world, the Vitra Design Museum, the MoMA in New York, the Stedelijk Museum Amsterdam. So there are maybe like only 50 made, but all of them are at very good places. They ended up at very good places.
Can I ask you something? It never went into production, in a mass production. It was only made limited edition.
Yeah, it was not meant as a limited edition, but it's very conceptual. So people bought it more as a piece of art. It's not like something you put around your dining table.
Okay.
So it's really for the collectors. Okay. And. So I have a view, and the value will go up. This is another piece by Arnoud Visser. He made this cell at sunrise, where there's only one container for the vinegar and the oil. Oil is lighter than vinegar, so it floats on top of the vinegar, and then he has two tubes, one for the oil and one for the vinegar. So he works with mathematics stuff. This is also an iconic Droog Design piece by Marcel Wanders. He made this not the chair. This was a project which was done in collaboration. A collaboration of Droog Design and the Technical University in Delft with the Department of Air Science, and they use this soft rope materials, which they then dipped in resin, and which then became hard. And based on the principles of Gaudi, he made this chair, which eventually became his most iconic piece. And another item in the very first show was this soft face by Helen Jongerius, also a classmate of mine at the Design Academy. And she made this sort of traditional urn shape face, and she made it in rubber. And then intentionally showing the lines of the molds, the misfits, as she calls it. And it's really a surprise, because when you see it, it looks like stone, and when you touch it, it's rubber, so it's also very handy, it doesn't break. That was the old days. Today I call myself a homo ludens, which is Latin for the playing man. It's a concept by Dutch art historian and philosopher Johan Huizinga. He wrote this essay in 1938, and he explains the role of playing in as culture. So that is, for him, playing is culture, and then he describes all the different fields of playing. And it's really my Bible. It's really an interesting book. It's about the fun and about experiment and. I learned that you can only have fun when you play serious. So people think when I talk about play, oh, it's not serious, it's just playing. But playing is, per definition, something which is very serious. If you don't do it serious, then it can't be fun. If you play Monopoly and you're on my hotel and you have to pay, and you don't go like, oh shit, and you say, well, whatever, then it's no fun. So you really have to believe in the game, and then you have the fun. It's also the famous Danish designer Hans Wegener also said, We must take care that everything doesn't get so dreadfully seriously. We must play, but we must play seriously. So it's a widespread. If you pay attention, it's more widespread than you would expect. A few years ago, I made a book titled "Works in Use." It's again about the people who use my work. The man was central in the book, the user, because eventually we design for people, and I find it also always very interesting how people put my stuff in their homes or in their lives. People always send me pictures of something I designed at their house, and I thought that's really nice, and it was meant really something to them, that they took the effort to take a picture and send it to me without knowing me. Came up with this idea to make this book, and I asked people on my website and in interviews and everywhere, like, please send me pictures of my work in use. So I made the book with a nice handle. It's really handy, this handle, because you can always find it in the bookshelf, and then you can carry it with you. And then people sent me pictures of my work in use. So on the cover of the book, you see this mug, which is sold like 500,000 already worldwide. And then somebody sent a picture of the mug using it as a toy for his pet, which was like, wow, amazing. Like, I could not come up with this idea of using my products, and I really loved it. The object, the dog became co-designer, and the object shape changed, which I really like. I designed it around 2000, I think, and it's still in production. It still sells more and more. The first time I used this handle for this mug was for the sit object. That's a piece of furniture I designed for the gardens of the Central Museum in Utrecht. They asked me to design garden furniture, but their garden was already finished. It was designed by a famous French garden designer. And he used all these different types of grass, high grass, low grass, and then they asked me to do seats and tables for their visitors to sit in the garden. So I didn't want to make something which was really attached to the garden. I wanted to make something which was like more like a piece of paper floating by the wind through the garden. But that sounded too poetical to me. I'm not a poet, I'm a designer. And then I looked in my own garden, and I saw the toys of my kids. I found that a really nice contrast with the garden. So I took this jumping ball, this bouncing ball, where it's a rubber ball for kids where they can sit and jump as a starting point. But I didn't make it from rubber material, but I made it from a hard material. I added two flat sides so it can function as a table. But I kept the handle of this bouncing ball, so you can also carry it around easily. You can lift it up and you can walk away with it. And the nice thing is, like we talked about before, I don't solve problems, I create possibilities. And people really see all these possibilities in my work, which I did not foresee, but everybody starts using this handle as a cup holder. Or for your baguette. So this was on a picture from somebody from Berlin who sent it to me for my book. This is in New York at the ICFF. And then this is Huip van Muilwijk. He was an intern in my studio. He really wanted to be in my book naked. So you can't see his face. But this is Huip van Muilwijk. So if you met him, then you know that he's the guy on the picture. And then somebody from Milan sent me this image of this object on this moped. Another design where I used this handle was the USB stick. This is what I found on the internet, also very nice to find of your work. I also used it for cutlery. And for many other items, this is a lamp called the Dandelion. It is one of the best sellers of one of my clients, the company from Holland called Mooi. Another client of mine is Christoffel from Paris. They are one of the most famous Swiss, France silversmiths. So they designed me. They asked me to design a collection for them. So I did some research in their factory, in their museum. I went to their history, almost 200 years of history. I went to their catalogs, and I really studied the material and looked how I could use this. And then I thought, what is the most beautiful about the silver is the reflection. So I focused on that, and then I found out that the reflection works the best on round spherical objects. So I used the sphere as a starting point. I made this Atome d'Argent collection. It's based on silver spheres. I made a candlestick for one candle. Can you see it? It looks really bright.
Somehow it's not really bright.
Pique Fleur, a silver vase for the same company. Another client of mine is Artifor. It's a very famous Dutch furniture maker. And for them, I designed the Epps sofa. It's a square with rounded corners, like the Epps on your phone.
This is an app?
This is a sofa.
Yeah.
So this here you can see it better. But the shape is sort of like your icon on your iPhone. That's why I called it apps. So I came up first with the idea, and then after I designed it, I thought, hey, that looks like an app. Let's call it the apps. So we have apps app 1.0 and apps 2.0. This is the cloud chair. Originally, I designed this for Christoffel, but Christoffel only does silverware, so I then decided that this is such a crazy piece, I really want to make it. So I decided to make it as a limited edition studio piece. And it's made in aluminium, nickel plated. And with the same typology as the cloud chair, I made the Layers book table. It's a chair made out of old books, which are then glued together using resin on top. And we also made a table with the same idea, where the tabletop really floats. That's a pity. The images are really poor, because the top is really super smooth and a nice pattern of book covers. And then later we made an industrial version of this book table in steel, which is now being produced by the second largest furniture company from Holland, Gispen, for whom I also do the art direction. And for that same company, I designed these leaves. Originally, I designed them for the Museum Boijmans van Beuningen from Rotterdam. They asked me to do their offices, and what I always find the most ugly in an office, like in this space, is this ceiling. You know, it's so incredibly ugly and depressing. And this museum is next to a park with these fantastic trees outside, and then you come inside, you have this ugly ceiling. So I thought, it would be nice if we can bring the trees from the outside to the inside. Let's cover the whole ceiling with leaves. And then we had to decide, well, how can we make these leaves? And this is probably foam, but their ceiling was from steel. So I said, okay, let's use magnets. And so then we made this leaf magnets, which you can then eventually apply on anything from metal. So everything which is dull, you can make undull, and which we were showing with this installation we showed in Milan in 2008.
And these leaves were made from what material?
It's sort of a silicon rubber. Mm-hmm. And they're mass produced, hundreds of thousands we sold, crazy. It's such a stupid product, but it's so much fun, and everybody who sees it likes it. So when we did this installation in Milan, people started to steal the leaves, which I found very funny, because this is nice. And then I walked through the town and I saw the leaves on crazy places, which was really cool. Another object where I use the layers, but it's really, we can skip this if you see this image. It's a low, the low res elephant. Originally designed for an interior of a building of MVRDV architects, famous architects from Rotterdam. And for that, I made a sort of a playground for kids. And for this playground, I blew everything up on a big scale. So this was like a miniature toy from my kids, which I then blew up. That's why it's sort of a pixelated shape. And that's why I called it low-res elephant. A lamp for the same company, Gispen, which was based on how can I use steel very efficient and create a 3D shape with it. This is how it looks from the bottom. So it's made from one sheet of metal laser cut, and then it's bent. And by pulling the material, the outline of this lamp is organically created. Also from one sheet of metal is this thunderball light for Gispen, where you get a flat plaque at home, and then you can fold it yourself in the shape you like the best. So you then I really try to involve the end user with this product. This was one was on your invitation for today. It's called the Layers Cloud Chair. This object is made out of solid wool. It's made out of Divina, which is a fabric from Quadraat. I designed this for Quadraat. And they did this event with their fabric, for which they asked like 20 or 25 designers to use their material to create something, whatever they wanted. Again, for this project, I really did some research on the material, but that was the only thing I had to use. And normally, this material is used to cover the object, like this chair. It's just the cover, the skin of an object. But I decided that I wanted to create something which was really made from this material, not as a surface, but as a construction material. And then I did some research in the material. I burned it, I scratched it, I did all kinds of crazy things with it to get a feeling with the material. And then I also found out that what are the qualities that I want to emphasize on, and that was really that the softness. It's super soft material, you really want to feel it, so I wanted to create a shape which was really tactile. What I also really liked is the color range they had. They have about 120 colors, and I used almost 100 of them. And it's a sort of, it's a woven material, but it has sort of a felt-like feeling, but you can cut it without getting ruffles. So then I decided to make this cloud chair shape and build it up in layers. So that was a very simple concept. You have a shape, and then you just make it in layers, and then you have a chair. Then the shit started, because then we had to really make this chair, and then we had to find out how we could cut this material in the shape. Each of the 545 layers is cut separately and then glued together. So we had to make 545 drawings for each layer. We had to make a different drawing. It had to be cut, it has to be stacked. So this is resulted in a chair which is solid wool. So the chair is about 250 kilos, which is a lot for a chair. And this we already found out during the design process. So we put it on three wheels, so at least you are able to roll it around. It took almost 600 hours to make this one piece of chair. So in the center of the seat there's a red dot, and people think there's a stick going through all the way down. Somebody said to me, but it's actually a layer which goes all the way to the edge of the chair.
Can I ask you, how many assistants did you have? Like, how many people worked on creating this?
For this project, I think two assistants helped me with creating it, and then we had to outsource the final manufacturing because each layer was CNC cut with a company who has that machine. We don't have that kind of machine. Mm-hmm. But totally, it was 600 hours. I think we worked 400 hours on designing, drawing, and engineering, and another 200 on building the piece.
So how many of these did you produce?
This is a one-off item. Mm-hmm. The value of the fabric itself is 60,000 euros. And this one was sponsored by Quadraat, but not so many people can and will buy this chair. It's now on tour. It's now traveling to Japan, China, and Australia, and hopefully we can then sell it in February during Art Dubai. Mm-hmm. There must be one buyer on the planet who wants to have this chair. I think out of all the 10,000 new designs which were launched this April in Milan, this is probably the one which was the most published around the world. It went really totally viral. Mm-hmm. Last thing I want to show you is this speaking pedestal. I designed it for the GEM, the Gemeentemuseum in The Hague, on request of this guy, which is Wim van Krimpen. He asked me to design this object to do a speech at an opening. For my work, I go a lot to this kind of openings. And these people, like this Wim van Krimpen, they started to talk and they can't stop. And it's very annoying, because you're at a nice opening, you see nice people, you see the champagne already waiting for you. And then these people keep on talking and talking, all these official people. I don't know how you feel it, but for me it's always very boring. So I decided to make something which you then really can roll away. So if somebody talks too much, you just simply roll him away and then the party can begin. So
he had a sense of humor since he went with it.
Yeah, he loved it. But in fact, the museum still has it, because at this moment I'm working on an interior for them. Uh-huh. And this is in The Hague, and the mayor of The Hague refuses to stand behind it. So if he has to come to open an exhibition or something, he refused to stand behind this. He says, then I'm not taking serious. And he went, of course, the mayor, you know, important guy, he thinks. So that was quite nice.
It won't work in Georgia either.
Hmm?
It won't work in Georgia either.
No, they're too serious. They take themselves too serious.
I don't think anyone will stand behind that.
Okay, well, that's a pity. Well, that's it so far. If you like, I can show you the movie of the cloud chair, if somebody can help me with this computer. Where's my stick? It's on the stick. There's a nice movie about the cloud chair. I think that one. Anyone? One above. Yeah, that one. So here you see each layer, of the chair slowly growing. So we had to make. Then we decided to also make an animation out of it. So what you see here in 1.5 minutes was done in 600 hours.
So did you also think about the colors and how would you arrange it? Or
So we did a thorough study about the colors. We looked at layers of earth, we looked at the painted desert, we looked at all kinds of things. And of course, we looked into the colors which they had. I decided that I wanted to use a lot of colors because that was one of the beauties of the materials. So basically I took all the colors which I like, which were like 100 colors. Mm-hmm. So this is 800 meters of fabric and a lot of time to create something which is more a piece of art than it is design, I would say.
Why would you say that? What makes this differentiation between?
Because it's not important that you can sit on it.
No.
People don't buy this to sit.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's also playful. I mean, it's fun. When you look at cloud chair, I think one of the reasons everybody was so popular, it was the playfulness.
Also.
You know, everybody would like to sit on a cloud, no?
That's my dream, you know. As a child, I dreamed of when I saw the clouds that I could rest on it because they look so nice and soft.
Can we see, like, I really like the one of the orange designs. You can tell us, or this room, which also is very playful.
Oh, yeah, shit. I didn't put it in my presentation. Maybe you have to plug in your computer.
Shit, Lavaro is from short. No, I don't think this. Yeah, we could do it or find the image on the internet.
Oh, you put that presentation on this stick?
Oh, yeah. Transfer that presentation.
Put it on the stick, you have to.
Meanwhile, if anybody has questions, Ramishek it Holocht, Star Wars Ardina, Rekha Dautarbi, and.
No questions?
I have a question. When you design an object, I wonder how does it go in mass production afterwards? You go for them to furniture companies or how it works?
Normally, companies come to me to ask me if I can design something for, and then I start to design.
But
for a younger designer?
Yeah, for younger designers.
Yeah, for you, how to start? Yeah, that's always a good question. How can you start? I was lucky that I made the right work in the right moment, and all of a sudden I became part of this droog design movement. And it's really hard. One way is to make it and present it to companies, but the chance of success are not that big. So you better make sure that you get some attention in what you do. Make something special, and if you want to design for a company, because I'm also creative director for Gispen, for example, and then I get a lot of designs which are either copies of what we already make, or copies of somebody else's work, or it's not mass producible, or it's not functional. So if you design for a company, then you have to think about this company and what they do. You have to think about the context where things work. So we get offered the most bizarre objects which will never fit into our collection. So if you offer something to a company, you should research about the company and look what fits in their collection.
Updated time by time, and how you decide to stop and say that this is the design I like, or something like that?
During the design process?
Yeah,
we keep on working on it until we're happy, until we think this is it. This is then we can I don't know how we decide. It's quite natural. So we design something and then we improve it, and then we see where the mistakes are. We improve it until it's ready. So if all the errors are out, then it's perfect.
And sometimes it's like you always want to make it better after one project is done. If you update and make the design better and better till the end.
So at one point, the design leaves our studio and goes in the world. Whether it's in an interior, or if it's a piece for a company, and then they will invest in tooling and developing the product. And then I cannot call them a half year later, like, oh, I have another idea. We have to change it. Throw away your 300,000 euros of investment, and we make the radius a little bit smaller. That's not how it works.
It happens in your mind, like, well, I could make it better.
Never.
Never.
No, because I make the best design, and then it's ready, and then it goes. I don't stop before it's finished. What inspires me the most? People. I like people, so I'm interested in people and how they behave and what they do and how they use their products or abuse products. And that I find very inspiring. But I can also be inspired by technology. Really enjoy going to factories to see what they can do. And to see what they can make and get inspiration from that.
Why not in
Somebody else has a question.
Can you give us an advice to young designers who want to introduce, for example, our works to walk?
And what is better, to go to London or Salone, which exhibitions are better for us? That's a tough question, because Milan, there is a lot of competition, but if you go to Salone Satellite, that's specially organized by the fair, that could be a good place if you want to, if you already have something which is ready for production, to find manufacturers that is working. Okay, but which one? Where are we going?
If it goes below, yeah, please. Oh. And because I think it's one of the. It was like playfulness to the maximum, I would say.
Yeah, definitely. This was a project for the hotel school in Maastricht. I advised the school, and what they wanted to do is to make a hotel for their students where they really could practice how it would work in a hotel. So it's a real hotel, you can book a room. And of course it's a school, probably same in Tbilisi, schools never have money, but they managed to get a lot of sponsors for materials. There was also not a big design fee, but sometimes I do these projects for fun, because if I don't get paid well, I make at least sure I have a lot of fun while designing it. So then I came up with this idea to make one hotel room like a swimming pool, the inside of a swimming pool. They are in Maastricht. There's a big tile industry, which was one of the sponsors, and so that was also a way to realize something in a low budget way. And I decided to use one tile and to make everything out of it. So this is a swimming pool. Everything is made of tiles, including the desk, including the bed. And then when you're laying in your bed, you see this big elephant swimming above you. And
was it a photo? Is it a photo?
It's a photo. So we had to Google this photo. It was actually quite expensive because we had to pay the photographer a lot of money to use this photo. But it's a very spectacular photo, actually, of an elephant swimming from the bottom. And so they have like 30 rooms, all are different. And this one is the most popular room. Everybody wants to stay in this room.
It's great. No, when I saw it, I thought that was really hilarious.
Great. Well, I had fun. Yeah. And still, until today, people have fun sleeping in there.
It's memorable. Because there are lots of hotels that want to make like room like Van Gogh from Van Gogh's painting, is that a remake? But this was quite original in terms of like being in a hotel room as a swimming pool.
Yeah, this is a quite radical statement.
Right. Great. Are there any more questions?
As I know, you are working with the manufacturers and searching for some designs for them. Is there any direction you're interested in now at this period of time? Some direction that is like really interesting and pops out right in this season, or I don't know.
What do you mean? What the trends, or I don't know.
The trends that you're looking for, manufacturers, or the trends that manufacturers are looking for.
So I'm not interested in trends. I think if you make trendy stuff, that means that you already half copy something. Like what we did with Droog Design, we were super original, and that is the power. And that is also my advice to all you here: find your own way, find your own style, find your own attitude, find your own personality in your work. Build that, and that is the only way. If you want to, suffer all the shit I've come to and really become a famous designer, then that's what you should do.
So, if you would be the one to choose from like lots of young designers, you would choose the one that is the most different from others, or the
Different, original, creative, it can be a lot of things.
Well,
how do you think a designer should work only on himself to develop his own style, or he may look to other designers' works to get some inspiration? Because with the development of internet, it became possible to see works of thousands of designers, but is it good or is it bad to see and get inspiration?
I'm not interested in that type of inspiration, but that's the way the most designers work. So you have a few originals, and there are a lot of copycats on this world, which follow trend. Of course, you have to know what's going on in the world, and you have to. So I know everything made by everybody, which is interesting. I'm aware of. Of course, all these designers, a lot of them are my close friends. But I prefer something which is original and authentic above something which is trendy and therefore never strong. What's so nice is about today is that there are all these different styles next to each other.
Yeah.
So some people are inspired by nature, some people like super minimalistic stuff, other people make Baroque stuff, and all these different styles are there, which is good, because there are a lot of different people on this planet, and there is not one favorite style or trend. Of course, technology is getting more and more important in design and new production types, like 3D printing creates the possibilities to make shapes which were never possible before to make.
Which ways do you prefer working on? Do you prefer the traditional way, for example, drawing with a pen or pencil?
Mm-hmm.
Or do you prefer the digital way, for example, 3D software or 3D Max?
Both. So I think it's very important that you know how to...
For example, the interior design.
Mm-hmm.
Which do you prefer, the traditional way or digital?
So the way we work is we make sketches, in my studio I make sketches by hand. I don't know how to use a computer, so I go to one of my assistants and he takes it from there into the digital world. But it always starts with a piece of paper. And I also think that it's important that you can draw as a designer, because I think that the way you draw is very has a very strong influence on your design.
So I'm interested, how would you describe your personal interior design?
What do you mean?
Your personal room.
My home.
Yeah.
It's very. Yeah, well, I have a special house, so I made a 300 square meter living room, so my kids can cycle in the house. So there's a lot of open space. So I think the quality in an interior is not the objects, but it is the space. Sometimes these stupid TV programs ask me, give an interior advice for our audience. So then I say, well, throw away half of your stuff, and then you have a lot of space. That always works. So I have a very open and flexible interior with a lot of art.
Well, thank you very much for finding time coming here. It was very, very useful. Thank you.
You're welcome.